Hello students, how are you? Students, today I will start a new chapter of science, that is lesson number 15, improvement in food resources. Now, why this improvement is in food resources is required? You know, India is a very populous country and day by day our population is increasing. As our population is increasing, the requirement of land for housing, industries, urbanization is also increasing. Now, the requirement of food is also increasing, but we do not have extra land to convert into agricultural land. So now we need to improve our food resources so that from the same land we can increase our production and we can get good cultivation. For this, there are various scientific approaches are studied. There are many scientific processes are implemented to increase the production of food to fulfill the food requirement and to meet the demand of growing population. Students, you know why food is necessary for our body? Food is any substance which is consumed to provide nutritional support for the body. It helps us to grow, to repair our body and to protect our body from diseases. Now, our food usually comes from two sources, that is plants and animal. This food contains essential nutrients, proteins, fats, vitamins, carbohydrates and minerals. Now, as I said, sources of food are plants and animals. We get all vegetables, fruits, herbs, spices from plants, and all non-vegetarian food is provided to us by animals. Now, sustainable agriculture. First, we will study how agriculture can be improved. Sustainable agriculture is the act of farming using principle of ecology, the study of relationships between organisms and their environment. It has been defined as an integrated system of plant and animal production practice having a site-specific application that will last over the long term. By sustainable agriculture, we can increase our production of food. There are various ways and there are various sources by which we can do this. Now I will tell you certain basic things about food. All living organisms essentially require food. Now early human beings, they started hunting animals and collecting fruits and roots of forest plants to meet their food requirement. Food supplies proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, minerals and water to our body. Only green plants can prepare their own food, so they are called autotrophs. While animals and human beings, they have to depend upon either plants or other animals for their food, so they are called heterotrophs. Farming and rearing of animals to meet food demand meet food requirements. Plants and animals product are used as food. Now we get food from plant, so we do agriculture. Now first I will tell you the basic difference between agriculture and crop. Agriculture means an applied, agriculture is an applied science which deals with the mass production of plants and animals. It involves soil cultivation, so management and breeding of crops and livestock, that is domestic animals. And crop means plants of same kind grown on a large scale to get useful product. So this is what exactly agriculture and crop means. Now how we can improve our agricultural production? So there are three approaches to improve our yield. First is crop production management, second is crop variety improvement, and third is crop protection management.
क्रॉप प्रोडक्शन. अ क्रॉप एज आई सेड इज एनी कल्टिवेटेड प्लांट, फंगस और एल्गी दैट इज हार्वेस्टेड फॉर फूड, क्लॉथिंग, लाइफ स्टॉक, फॉडर, बायोफ्यूल, मेडिसिन और अदर यूजेस. एंड एनिमल्स आर रेज्ड बाय ह्यूमंस एंड आर कॉल्ड लाइफ स्टॉक एक्सेप्ट दोज दैट आर केप्ट एज पेट. नाउ एक्चुअली लाइफ स्टॉक इज कंसिडर्ड एज दोज एनिमल्स विच आर यूटिलाइज बाय फार्मर्स फॉर सम फार्म वर्क, दैट इज फॉर लेबोरियस वर्क और फॉर द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ मिल्क. राइट. नाउ फर्स्ट आई विल टेल यू समथिंग अबाउट फूड क्रॉप्स, दैट इज सीरियल्स सच एज व्हीट, राइस, मेज, मिलेट. दिस क्रॉप्स प्रोवाइड अस कार्बोहाइड्रेट विच गिव्स अस एनर्जी, वेयर एज पल्सेस लाइक ग्राम, ब्लैक ग्राम, ग्रीन ग्राम, पिजन पी, दिस पल्सेस प्रोवाइड अस विथ प्रोटीन एंड प्रोटीन हेल्प आवर बॉडी टू ग्रो एंड रिपेयर अवर डैमेज पार्ट, वेयर एज ऑयल सीड सच एज सोयाबीन, ग्राउंड नट, सिसमे, दे प्रोवाइड अस फैट विच इज़ रिक्वायर्ड बाय अवर बॉडी, विच प्रोवाइड एनर्जी टू अवर बॉडी. एंड वेजिटेबल्स, स्पाइसिस एंड फ्रूट्स, दे प्रोवाइड विटामिन्स एंड मिनरल्स टू अवर बॉडी. सो ऑल टुगेदर वी नीड ऑल द टाइप ऑफ फूड फॉर द कम्प्लीट डेवलपमेंट ऑफ अवर बॉडी. सो अलॉन्ग विद दिस क्रॉप और फूड क्रॉप, there are some fodder plants are also grown which is known as fodder crop, like bearseem, oats and sudan grass. This fodder crop is used by animals as their food. Now students, as we know that different types of crops require different climatic condition, it means all the types of crops are not grown throughout the year. So according to the requirement of climatic condition, temperature and photo period for the growth and completion of the cycle of crops are classified into kharif crop and rabi crop. Now there are some crops which are grown only in rainy season, that is from April to October. These crops are known as kharif crops. Kharif crops are crops such as paddy, soyabean, pigeon pea, maize, cotton. These are examples of kharif crop. Whereas rabi crops are grown in winter season. Rabi crops or rabi crops refers to the agricultural crops so sown in winter and harvested in the spring. The term is derived from Arabic word for spring, which is used in the Indian subcontinent. It is the spring harvest, also known as winter crop. In Indian subcontinent, there are time period is from November to April. Now, examples of rabi crops are wheat, gram, peas, mustard, linseeds are all examples of rabi crops. Now in India there has been an increase in the production of food grain from 1952 to 210, with only 25% increase in the cultivation of land. And this was possible because of three major factors, that is food variety improvement, food production improvement and crop protection management. First we will see crop production management. Crop production management refers to the various processes applied towards the effective cultivation and harvesting of crop. Now this crop production management includes nutrient management, irrigation and cropping fatigue. Essential plant nutrients are, actually there are altogether 16 types of nutrients are required by plant. Carbon, hydrogen and oxygen are the nutrients which are absorbed by the plants from air and water. That is carbon and hydrogen are absorbed by the plants from air in the form of carbon dioxide, whereas hydrogen and oxygen are absorbed by the plants through water in the form through water as H2O. Now remaining 13 nutrients are absorbed by the plants from soil. Now the plants require nutrients in different proportion, that is different amount. There are 6 nutrients which are required by the plant in large quantity, and they are called macronutrients. In macronutrients also, again there are 2 types, that is primary nutrients as well as secondary nutrients. Nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium are required by the plants in large amount, whereas calcium, magnesium and sulfur are required in little less amount as compared to those previous 3. So altogether there are 6 types of macronutrients, and these nutrients are provided to the plants by soil. Whereas the remaining 7 types of nutrients, that are zinc, copper, manganese, iron, boron, molybdenum, chlorine, nickel, these nutrients are required by plants in small amount, and so they are called micronutrients. So altogether macro and micronutrients as well as carbon, hydrogen and oxygen are responsible for proper growth and development of plants. Now as these nutrients are required by the plant and it fulfill the basic needs of the plant, but sometimes deficiency of these nutrients affect physiological processes in plants, such as growth, reproduction and diseases. To increase the yield, the soil can be enriched by supplying these nutrients in the form of manure as well as fertilizers. As continuous cultivation of crops in the same field sometime used up all the nutrients which are present in that soil, and soil becomes degraded, that is the quality of soil become deficient. It means there is deficiency of nutrients in that soil, and now this deficiency can be fulfilled by artificially adding either manure or fertilizers in that soil, so that we can give back the soil its nutrients which are already used up. Now manure is the organic matter mostly derived from animals excreta and wastage of plant. Now this manure is organic matter, so it does not contain any harmful chemicals, but it is obtained from all natural things such as plants and animal waste. This manure can be made in the farm itself, and it does not require much expense to make it. Now to make manure, actually pit are made in the farm, and all plants and animal waste is put in that pit, and it is covered from the top. Now because of heat of sun and because of moisture from the soil, all this plant and animal waste decompose and it is converted into organic manure. Now this manure provide humus to the plant, and it increases the fertility of soil, and also it increases the water holding capacity of soil. Now this manure contain more humus and less nutrients. So along with manure, certain fertilizers are also required by the plant to fulfill the need of specific nutrients or specific minerals. There are 2 types of manure, that is compost and green manure. Now compost is the organic matter that has been decomposed and recycled as a fertilizer and soil amendment. Compost is a key ingredient in organic farming. It is prepared from plants and animal waste such as excreta, fecal matter, etc. Now another type of compost is vermicompost. Vermicompost is the product or process of composting using worms. As I said, in compost
only waste is put in the pit and it is covered, whereas in vermicompost, along with the waste, some worms are also put. Now these worms actually increase the process of decomposition, and it makes the process faster. It breaks down the organic matter and it convert all the waste material into compost. So the difference between compost and vermicompost is that much only, ke in vermicompost earthworms are used. This earthworm actually turn the waste and make the decomposition process faster. Now manure and compost and vermicompost are made from farm waste as well as animal waste. Green manure is something different. It is not made from waste, but it is a type of plants like sun hemp and gourd. They are grown before the actual crop is grown in the field. Once these crops, they grow very faster. So once this crop grows, then it is the field is plowed and this crop is mulched before the actual seeds are grown. Now these green crops mixes with the soil and increases the fertility, as actually the nutrients which are present in the soil goes down. So as when these crops are grown, they pull the nutrients and bring it to the top layer of soil, and when it is mulched along with the soil, it mixes with the soil and makes the soil fertile. So when actual rich crops are grown, soil is already enriched with nitrogen and phosphorus and other nutrients, and it increases the production of the crop. Now we'll see fertilizers. Now actually fertilizers are not natural or organic compound, but they are inorganic compound, or we can say they are chemicals which are added to the soil to increase its fertility. These fertilizers are rich in nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium and some of the minerals. Now these fertilizers are not made in farm, but they are produced in factories. They are manufactured in factories. So they are synthetic, or you can say they are inorganic matter. Now this fertilizers, they contain very less humus and they contain more of nutrients. Fertilizers are little expensive as compared to manure. Now as fertilizers consist of less humus, it provides no water, or it increases no water holding capacity of plant. It provides only specific nutrients to the soil, and it excessive use or long term of use of fertilizers is harmful. It pollutes the water table, as when the fertilizers go deep into the soil along with water, it disturbs the water table, it pollutes the water table, and long term of fertilizers reduces the humus present in the soil and degrade the quality of soil. So fertilizers have only short term uses, but long term of or excessive use of fertilizer is harmful to soil as well as water. We know that in India farming is rain fed, that is the success of crop in most of the area depend upon the timing of monsoon and sufficient rainfall. Now because of poor monsoon season or excessive rain, many a time crop fails. To overcome this, irrigation is necessary. Irrigation is the artificial application of water to the land or soil. It is used to assist in the growing of agricultural crop, maintenance of landscapes and revegetation of disturbed soil in the dry area and during the period of inadequate rainfall. Now India has a wide variety of water resources and a highly varied climate. Under such condition, several different kind of irrigation system are adapted to supply water to the agricultural land depending on the kind of water resources available. Now these agricultural resources are well tanks, canal system, river valley system, and these provide water to the crop where whenever rainfall is not sufficient or in the areas where water facilities are not available or rainfall is not proper. Now due to this irrigation system, nowadays we can increase the production of crop by planting the crops in many areas where rainfall is not sufficient or where the land is dry and far away from water reservoirs. This irrigation system has helped us to increase our agricultural production and to meet the demand of food to the increasing population. Cropping patterns. Different ways of growing crops can be used to give maximum benefit. It means on the same land, crops are grown in different patterns so that the crop can be protected from disease. Even the nutrient requirement of the crop can be met and more and more growth can be obtained from the same piece of land. Different cropping patterns are mixed cropping, intercropping and crop rotation. Now first I'll explain you what is mixed cropping. Mixed cropping is growing of two or more crops simultaneously on the same piece of land. It is also known as multiple cropping. In this way, in the same land, if two types of crops are grown and the selection of crops is done in such a way that nutrient requirement of both the crops are opposite, so that the maximum nutrients from the soil can be obtained by the plants and they can grow very well and more agricultural product can be obtained. Another cropping pattern is intercropping. Intercropping means growing of two or more crops simultaneously on the same field in a definite pattern. A few rows of one crop are grown and the few rows of second crop are grown. Now the crops are chosen in such a way that their nutrient requirements are again different, and this ensures maximum utilization of nutrients supplied and also prevent pest and disease from spreading to all the plants. Suppose if one type of crop gets diseases, then as it spreads to first three rows, then it will stop as the fourth row is of another crop. Sometimes, you know, certain diseases are caused only to that particular type of plant and it will not spread in the next type of plant. So this way farmers can at least protect some of their farm product by using this cropping patterns. The crops are chosen or selected maybe soybean plus maize or finger millet plus cowpea. Their nutrient requirements are different and they can absorb all different types of nutrient from the soil. Now the third cropping pattern is crop rotation. In crop rotation, different crops are grown on the piece of land in a pre-planned succession. It means suppose in first 3 months one type of crop is grown, it is harvested, and then again another type of crop is grown. The benefit of this crop rotation is that if one type of crop suppose absorb a particular type of nutrients from the soil, then there will be deficiency of that particular nutrition in that soil. So in the next once this crop is harvested, another crop is chosen in such a way that its nutrient requirement is totally different from the previous one, so that soil will get time to replenish its lost nutrient, and the another crop which is grown is not having the requirement of that particular nutrient, so it can grow well in the deficiency of that particular nutrients also. This way we can increase our growth and we can save our crops from disease also, and we can get more and more crop from the same area of land. Now one of the activity of improving crop yield is crop variety improvement.
Crop variety improvement is done for following factors such as higher yield, improved quality, biotic and abiotic resistance, change in maturity duration, wider adaptability, desirable agronomic characteristic. Now first we will see what is higher yield. How higher yield can improve the crop variety? Higher yield means to increase the productivity of crop per acre, means how we can get same more crop or more product from the same area of land. This can be done by using so many scientific things, as we have already learned that by using fertilizers and manure, by implementing the process of irrigation, by all this we can get, and even by using good quality of seeds. Now this yield, higher yield can be done by even hybridization and by getting genetically modified crops. Then another factor is improved quality. Quality consideration of crop product vary from crop to crop. Now suppose in wheat, baking quality is important, whereas in pulses, oil quality is important, and in oil, in fruits and vegetables, preserving qualities are important. Such things can be done by using good quality of seeds, and by even hybridization we can obtain the best result. Biotic and abiotic resistance. Now we know that crop can go down due to, the production of crop can go down due to disease, insects and nematodes. These are the biotic factors, whereas the abiotic factor which harm the crops are drought, salinity, water logging, heat, cold, frost. Because of this also the quality of crop goes down. So the varieties of crops which resist this stress can improve the crop production. Now again this can be done by choosing the best quality of seeds, and by doing hybridization, or you can say by doing cross pollination between two different varieties, we can get this resistance, and the new crop which is obtained may have all the factors which can ensure good growth of crops. Now change in maturity period. First of all, what is maturity duration? The time period between the when the seed is sown to the crop is harvested, that this entire time period is known as maturity duration. Now as more is the maturity duration, the farmers have to pay more attention to the crop. They have to look after the field for a longer time, so they have to spend their time as well as they have to spend their money also. If this maturity duration is shorter, it will be beneficial for the farmer, and in 1 year on the same piece of land they can grow more number of crops. So this way they can increase their income and they can increase their production also. The next factor of crop variety improvement is wider adaptability. Now as we know that particular crop grow in particular climatic condition, in particular season, and in particular type of soil. Now if we develop the variety of crop for a wider adaptability, it will help in establishing the crop production under different environmental condition, and one variety can be grown under different climatic condition in different areas. So you know earlier certain food products were available in particular area only, and from that area it has to be transported to other area. But nowadays many of the varieties are grown on different part of the country, and this way our production has also increased. So wider adaptability is also a major factor which can improve crop variety. And the last one is desirable agronomic characteristic. Now what are these desirable agronomic characteristic? We know that tallness
and profuse branches are desirable characteristic for fodder crops. You know, in fodder crops, as length of the plant is more, it is more beneficial. So such varieties are produced of fodder plant which have tall branches. In the same way, in the crop of cereals, tallness is not at all required. Only the quality of seeds are should be good. So dwarfness is the desired in cereals, so that less nutrients are consumed by these crops. Thus, developing varieties of desired agronomic characters help give higher productivity. These are some important terms to improve crop variety. First is genetic manipulation. This genetic manipulation refers to alternation of gene on an organism. Actually, in certain plants, introducing a new gene that would provide the desired characteristic is done. This results in genetically modified crop. Another factor is hybridization. Hybridization refers to crossing between genetically dissimilar plants. This crossing may be intervarietal, that is between two different varieties, interspecific, that is between two different species of the same genus, or intergeneric, that is between two genera. So by this genetic manipulation and hybridization, we can get good result, good variety of crops, and all the factors which we have studied, that is improved quality, biotic, abiotic resistance, all these things can be overcome. Students, now we will see what is crop protection management. See, if we grow crops using good quality of seeds, if we take care of the harvest, and but due to some reason, if the protection of crop is not done properly, then there are chances of destroying the crops. So we will see the methods of crop protection management. First is weed control. Now, you know what are weeds? Weeds are unwanted plants which grow along with the our actual crop. Now, weeds compete with the plants for sunlight and for nutrients, and due to this, the growth of actual crop stunts. It reduces. So to protect the plants from weed, we have to remove the weeds either by mechanical method or by chemical method, by using certain chemicals. Now, mechanical methods are simply by uprooting the weeds with hands, or by plowing, or by burning. These are the mechanical methods, whereas the chemical methods are by using certain weedicides and herbicides. By spraying these weedicides and herbicides, weeds are destroyed and we can protect our crop. Now, there are cultural method also, by preparing proper bed preparation, even by intercropping and crop rotation also, we can avoid this weed, or we can control weed. There are some biological methods also, that is use of certain insects and some other organisms. So in this way, if we remove weeds from the field, we can grow our crop properly and we can get good yield. Okay, apart from weeds, the another threat for the crop is insects and pests. So it has to be controlled. Generally, insect pests attack the plants in three different ways: either by cutting the roots, stems and leaf, or by sucking the cell sap from various part of the plants, or they bore into the stem and fruit. Thus, they affect the health of crop and reduce the yield. Disease in the plants are caused by pathogens such as bacteria, fungi and viruses. Now these pathogens can be present in and transmit through the soil, water and air. So either they enter the plants through soil or water or air. See the way in which this pathogen enter our body. Even human beings are infected by pathogens, that is microorganisms. How they enter? Either by drinking water or by eating food or by breathing contaminated air. So in the same way, these pathogens affect the plants. Now altogether, weeds, insects and disease can be controlled by various methods. By spreading weedicides, we can control weeds. In the same way, by spraying insecticides, we can control insects and pests. Some other preventive measures against pests are use of resistant varieties. We have studied that genetic manipulation can resist the, they have good disease resistance control. Then even the summer plowing helps to some extent in controlling weeds, like plowing deep in summer to destroy weeds and pests. So summer plowing is also one of the method to control these weeds and pests. So by growing proper crops, the problem is not solved. It has to be managed properly and it has to be protected properly. Then only we can increase our agricultural production. Now just by sowing good qualities of seed, growing good quality of plants and protecting the plant from weeds and pests is not enough. After harvesting the crop, the proper storage of grains is also equally important, because storage losses in agricultural produces can be very high. Now these crops can be crop losses can be affected by two main factors, that is biotic factor and abiotic factor. Biotic factors are insects, rodents, fungi, mites and bacteria, whereas abiotic factors are inappropriate moisture, temperature in the place of storage. So these may these factors may cause degradation in the quality, loss in the weight, poor germinability, discoloration of produce, all leading to poor marketability. So ultimately, whatever is grown in the field has to be sold in the market. If the value of crop or the quality of crop is not as per the standards, then its market value goes down, and that is why it has to be stored properly. Now actually this grains has to be stored in a big warehouses. Now cleanliness is must, and that place should be properly dried, and insecticides and pesticides are spread to kill the pest. These insecticides and pesticides are chemicals which has to be spread, and all the care has to be taken so that the grains remain in its standard form and the quality does not goes down. So all prevention and control measures are used before the grains are stored so that its market value remains high. These are the methods of storing grains. First, all the grains are dried, that is all the grains are spread in sunlight for the entire day. Then after, these same grains are placed in shadow so that again they becomes come to normal temperature. Then they are cleaned, all the weeds are removed, all husk and all everything is removed from it. They are cleaned properly and then they are properly stored in the warehouse or containers which are previously fumigated, and some chemical are sprayed on it, and that it should be ensured that no moisture should be there in the container. Even the sometimes the containers are also kept in sunlight, or they are completely dried before storing these grains. So proper storage is equally important as the crop, even the to protect the crop from insects and to use the good variety of seeds. So proper storage help the farmers to get good income. Now students, we will study about animal husbandry. Animal husbandry is the scientific management of animal livestock, including their feeding, breeding and disease control. Animal farming includes cattle, sheep, goat, poultry and fish farming. Now first we will see what is cattle farming. This word is very familiar to us and you all must be knowing about it. Cattle farming is done for two main purposes. They are for milk production and for labor work. Milk producing females are called milch animal, whereas the cattle which are used for laborious work in farms are called draught animals. Milk production depends on the duration of lactation period. Now you know what is lactation period? The period of milk production after the birth of calf, that period is called lactation period. Milk production can be increased by increasing the lactation period. You know, this female cattle does not give milk throughout their life. When they give birth to the calf, then after giving birth, after for few months they produce milk. So that period is called lactation period. Now lactation period is not same in all type of cattle. In Indian breed, lactation period is little less, but in foreign breed they have longer lactation period. Foreign breed like Jersey and Brown Swiss have long lactation periods, and local breed like Red Sindhi and Sahiwal are resistant to disease. They can be crossbred to get animal with both the qualities. Now see, if lactation period is longer and if the same animal have good disease resistance power, then it is very beneficial for the cattle farmers. So crossbreeding is done between these two, and both the desired character can be acquired in a single animal. Cattle shelter should be clean and well ventilated with sloping floors for easy cleaning. Now to ensure good health of cattle, there should be some management. First thing is cleanliness of shelter is must, otherwise if the animal fall ill, the milk producing capacity reduces, or sometime animal may die, and which is a great loss to cattle farmers. Along with cleanliness, the health of cattle is also affected by feeding habits. So food of the cattle should be managed properly. Cattle feed should include roughage containing mainly fibers and concentrate containing protein and other nutrients. It means cattle require two types of food, that is roughage and concentrate. Roughage, it consists of fibers which maintain overall health of the cattle, and even the digestion of cattle remains proper, and concentrate give proper nutrients and protein to the cattle, which increases their milk producing capacity. Cattle diseases are caused by pests, bacteria and virus. External pests cause skin disease. Internal pests like worms affect stomach and intestine, and fluke damage the liver. Vaccinations are given to protect from viral and bacterial diseases. So there are three important things to be managed. First is the cleanliness of shelter, second is food, and the third one is disease control. So as we fall ill, in the same way cattle also fall ill, and this pest by which they fall ill may be internal as well as this external. So regular vaccination ensures good overall health of the cattle. So they should be vaccinated regularly to protect them from diseases. Apart from this, you know, if sometime cattle fall ill, there are veterinary doctor which we can consult them and get medicines to cure them. Once the cattle fall ill,
it produces less milk. If it is a drought cattle like ox or bullock, they will not able to work in the farm, or they will not able to carry the cart. So both the ways, milch animal as well as dry drought animal, require proper care for their shelter, health as well as food. Students, here you can see the pictures of cattle breed, that is Gir, Red Sindhi and Sahiwal. These are all Indian breed, and you can even see the breeds of buffalo, that is Murrah, Surti and Mehsana. These cattle are used for the production of milk. Poultry farming. Poultry farming is done for two purposes, that is production of egg and meat. Now, improved poultry breed are developed to produce layers for eggs and broilers for meat. Now, the poultry which is raised for the production of eggs are called layers, whereas which are raised for the production of meat are called broilers. Crossbreeding between Indian variety like Asil and foreign variety like Leghorn is done to develop new varieties. For good production of poultry bird, they are given proper nutrients and kept in hygienic condition and proper temperature condition. See students, birds are very sensitive to temperature. You must have heard about migratory birds, because the temperature in some of the part of the world goes very down. So this migratory bird come to India in the winter season because they are very sensitive to temperature. In the same way, poultry birds are very sensitive to temperature. Very high temperature or very low temperature can kill them. So proper maintenance of temperature in poultry farm is equally important. Now, broiler chickens are fed with vitamins, proteins and fat rich food for better growth. Now, in egg laying chicken, size of the poultry bird is not at all important, because only the size and quality of egg is given importance. Whereas in case of broilers, the size of chicken is equally important to maintain its market value. So the carcass of the chicken should be proper, and even the feather of the chicken should be good, so that which displays the good health of the poultry bird. Poultry fowl are affected by disease caused by virus, bacteria, fungi and parasite. They are protected from disease by proper sanitation, spraying, disinfectant and vaccination. So even same as cattle, the cleanliness of shelter, food of the chicken and regular vaccination to control their health. All the three factors are equally important, which ensures good health of the poultry animals, which increases the production and which increases the income of the poultry farmers. Fish production, which is also known as pisciculture, because scientific name of fish is piscis. Fish, is the cheapest and very important source of protein in our food. Now, there are two ways of obtaining fish. They are obtained from natural sources by using net, which is called capture fish farming. And another source of fish is culture farming. In culture farming, artificial ponds are or reservoirs are made, and seeds of fish are put in it, and fish are produced. This is called culture farming. The water sources of fish can be sea water, that is marine water, or fresh water like river, pond, lake, etc. Marine fisheries. The popular marine fish varieties are pomfret, mackerel, tuna, sardines, etc. They are caught by fishing net from boat. Some marine fishes are farmed in seawater. These include prawns, mullets, pearl spots, mussels, oyster, etc. We get pearl from oyster. Students, you must have heard about real pearl. Real pearl are not made from plastic or glass. They are produced by oysters. So oyster farming is actually done to obtain pearl, and it is also a kind of culture fishery, and as it is done in salty water, it is called mariculture. Now, inland fisheries. Culture fishery is done in fresh water and brackish water. Brackish water means the sea water and fresh water mixed together. Sometimes fish culture is done in combination with paddy crop in the field. This is called composite fish culture. Now, you know, to increase the income of farmer along with farming, they also do this fish production. So those farmers who are engaged in the production of rice, they along with the paddy crop, they put seeds of fish. You know, to grow paddy, first they have to dug some part of the farm and they put they pour water in it, and then they put seeds of rice. The water which is filled is almost up to knee length. So in the same water, if they put the seeds of fish along with paddy, they can produce fish and they can increase their income. The common fish in inland fish farm are rohu, katla, mrigal, grass crab, silver crab, common crab, etc. You can see the picture of this fish in the slide. And the last part of the animal husbandry is beekeeping, that is also known as apiculture. Beekeeping is done to obtain honey and wax. Honey is used as source of energy and also has medicinal uses. Wax is used in medicinal preparation and for making polishes. The local varieties of bee used for honey production are Indian bee, rock bee, little bee. The Italian variety of bee is also being used for large scale production of honey. The bee collects nectar from flowers and is convert it into honey in the beehive. Bees are artificially grown in apiaries, and the honey is extracted by a machine called honey extractor. In the figure you can see even honeybee and honey extractor. Now there are certain qualities in Italian bee, that is it stays in the beehive for longer period of time and breed well. It collect honey in large amount, it collect nectar from the flowers in large amount and can produce large amount of honey. And it sting less, it means it bites less. So these are the desired characters of honey bee, which are all found in Italian bee, and so mostly Italian bees are used for producing honey. Now quality of honey. Quality of honey does not depends upon the type of bee, but it depends upon the pasturage from which nectar is collected. Pasturage means the flowers and greenery which are found nearby, from which honeybee collect nectar. This pasturage determines the taste and quality of honey. So students, it is not like that all the honey are of different kind. You can see in the market different price and different qualities of honey are available, and this quality of honey depends upon the flower from which honeybee suck nectar. So whenever you go to purchase honey, please see that from which type of pasturage the nectar is collected and from which area the honey is coming, so that you can make sure that you can get good quality of honey. Okay students, with this I end this chapter. Thank you and bye.